for your ministry to us here this morning. Those of you who are playing on instruments, thank you for allowing God to use your skill, your ability, and the worship of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to talk to all of my Twitter friends and YouTube and Facebook, all of that, who are connecting by means of the web. And I just want you to know how much we love you. Thank you for those in the radio audience who love the Lord Jesus Christ, who oftentimes listen to this program, this ministry. Pray for us that God's name may be glorified. We invite you to come and to worship with us here in this particular local church. Well, I've got a tough subject this morning that I want your full attention. It asks the question, as the bulletin does God curse man? Does God curse man? Remember, we have been dealing with the book of Genesis and looking at Genesis chapter 3. And we remember in that particular chapter where God says to the serpent, "Cursed, you are cursed above all of the beasts of the field. Although you are wise, yet the curse of God fell upon him, and he crawls on his belly today as a serpent because of the curse that God placed upon the serpent." Then he says to Adam, he said, "Adam, because you have listened to and obeyed your wife in direct opposition to doing what I told you to do, because you did this, curse is the ground for your sake. In the sweat of your brow, you're going to have to work hard in order to earn a living." So God did curse the serpent. God did curse the ground. But there's nowhere that he said he cursed Adam. But there is a verse that talks about what God was going to do. Look at Genesis chapter 5, and I believe it's 29, when he said, "And he called his name Noah, saying, 'This one will comfort us concerning our work and the toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord God has cursed.'" So what does it mean to be cursed? It means to be despised by God. It means to be given an assignment that we don't really want to receive. And so the question becomes, can mankind be cursed of God? Has God ever cursed a man? I was reading in my notes the other day, and this man, of course, he served the Lord a long, long time ago, 16th, 17th century, I believe. I couldn't find a publishing date, but he made the statement, and a lot of people have read the statement, and a lot of people have accepted it as the gospel truth. When he made the statement, and his name was Matthew Henry. How many of you have his commentaries? They're still around, right? He wrote way back there before, I don't know exactly, but I think before the invention of the printing press. So a lot of people have read Matthew Henry. Now, listen to what he said, and I do not agree with this. Theologians, they do not agree with it, but it is written, and once you put it in print, people can pick it up and read it. And he said in his book, "By this speech of Lamech," remember we talked about Lamech last week, the man who brought abusive situations into the home, Lamech, Genesis chapter 4, and then in Genesis chapter 5. And he said, not only did he bring abusive situations to the home, but he kind of initiated polygamy. But one man has more than one wife. And he said to the wives of Lamech, "Hear my speech, ye wives of Lamech. I killed the man because he opposed me. And I want you to know something. You can't take vengeance on me because God said you can't take vengeance on Cain, who killed his brother, his blood brother. And God said you cannot take vengeance on Cain because he killed his brother Abel. Be merciful to him." Now, but Lamech was a man who started polygamy. He had wives. And nowhere in the Word of God where God ever justified that. Although the practice was picked up by who? Solomon? By who? David? By who? Even Abraham. Polygamy, one man living with many wives, was replete in the Old Testament. Now, don't you praise God that they lived in the Old Testament? So, brothers, if we ever thought we wanted to bring that on today, let me tell you something. Don't try. The lady from the AIDS Task Force came here and ministered to us on Wednesday, and the youth. And I'm so glad to see them around. And she said, the one thing that is happening in our world today, in northern Indiana, in Allen County, they have 264 known cases of the AIDS virus. In Marion County, in Annapolis, Indiana, they had 2,200 cases of the AIDS virus. So it's growing by leaps and bounds, and I'm not here to just tell you what the AIDS Task Force said, but I do want you to know that that information is available to us today. And the Red Cross is asking for blood donation. And what they do now is they test the blood to make sure that this AIDS infection germ is not in it before it is transfused. And somebody else gets a hold to this AIDS virus. Now, I simply wanted to insert that to let us know today that if a man and his future bride have been pure and moral in their relationship, they do not have to worry about catching the AIDS virus from another human being, this human immune deficiency syndrome that comes up. And what it does is it brings on a sense of pneumonia, and you can't fight off the pneumonia, and people die. And let me tell you something. I'm saying this as a pastor, because I've stood by the bedside of some young men, 17 years old, who could not shake the virus and, of course, died. And the mother is still grieving, crying over that. So morality is important. And we don't believe that polygamy is the way that it should go. I don't care who says it's okay. It is not approved by God in His Word. Okay? But this man made a statement, and I'm saying here, by his speech, Lamech, which is here recorded, and probably was much talked of in those times, he further appears to have been a wicked man, as Cain's cursed race generally were. Now, I take issue with that statement, because Cain's race was never cursed by God, okay? I'm not going to deal with Noah. I know what Noah did in Noah 9:25. I understand all of that. But God has never cursed a race of people. And that has brought much trauma to mankind. Probably one of the fueling issues in terms of the Civil War and probably racial separation and oppression by some people saying that this man should be my slave and he should work because God cursed him when that is not the case. But the question comes, is it possible for mankind today to ever be cursed? And I may have some sad news for us, but biblically speaking, when you trace this through the Old Testament, God warns again and again that there are certain things that we are supposed to do. If we do not do those certain things, we will fall under the curse of God and there will be judgment brought against us. Now you want to know what those things are, don't you? Yes, I know. Let me relieve your tension here. God never curses a man. The serpent, the ground, and as we read about Noah, God says the ground is cursed, and therefore I must bring a flood upon the earth, and I will bring that flood upon the earth, and the wickedness of man is so great in the earth until it breathed the heart of God that he had even created man. Genesis 6 and verse 8. God's heart was brought into pain and agony because of the wickedness of mankind. You see, when we talked about the fall of mankind, the fall was total. And there are different ways that people approach this, and I'm not going to one group that obviously is wrong, very popular group in our community and in our town, who believe that somehow man can overturn the curse by doing good deeds. I don't care how much you serve, how much you give. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13, though I give my body to be burned, I give everything that I have, you cannot overturn the curse. Whereas the Bible does suggest that believers ought to be involved in good works. But believers must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and trust the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior before they can receive blessings from the Lord. Now, obviously, God does allow the rain to come on the just and on the unjust. Amen? He does allow that. We thank God for his compassion. And I say oftentimes as I look at Titus chapter 3, it says that we too were sometimes ignorant, you know, being deceived and deceiving others. But then, the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared. That's one of the greatest verses, Titus 3, what is it? 5, I believe it is. 4 and 5. But then the kindness of God, our Savior, appeared. It's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it's according to God's mercy that he saved us. Hallelujah. You want to stand up and shout? You can shout on that one. He saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. And that is some kind of a verse. I challenge you this week to go to it and read it, Titus chapter 3. Read 1 at least through verse 7. He saved us by the washing, by the flooding of our hearts through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and cleansing us because of our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's how you got saved. If you're saved, you're saved because you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. And once you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I believe that the Bible teaches that you're saved and you are eternally secure in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you can never, ever lose your salvation. That's the hope we have in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Read about it in John 10, 27 and 28, where he said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. And they follow me, and no man is able to pluck them out of my hand. For my Father who gave them to me is greater than all, and nobody is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father, we are one." So you can rejoice in that. Don't ever let the devil rob you of the victory that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if he can cause us to doubt whether or not we have believed, he will defeat us. Then you go to the book of Romans 8 as well, where it talks about, "I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor persecution, nakedness, sore apparel, nothing is able." Amen. To separate us from who? From the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. So the love of God is strong on behalf of those who have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. And no matter what happens in life, the evil one cannot pluck you out of the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. And because of the love of God, you cannot be separated from him. Amen?
Amen?
So therefore, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, "If any man be in Christ, he is what?
New creation."
He is a new creation. He makes us over again. And if we're in Christ, we become a new creation. Well, I have just been reformed. No, it's not a matter of reformation. But when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and invite him into your heart and into your life, you become a new creation in Christ. As the old folk used to say, "I look at my hands. My hands look new. I look down at my feet, and they did too. I'm a new man now. I don't do what I used to do." Somebody told the story once of a lady who was a street woman, and she got saved. And the brothers who had visited her, they knocked on her door. "Hey, I'm so-and-so." She said, "Who?" "Yeah, I'm so-and-so." She said, "I'm sorry, I got a new man in this house." "I got a new man in this house. His name is Jesus. And I don't need you coming in here anymore. So don't come back." Amen? Yeah. That woman at the well, she had her troubles, didn't she? Oh, yes. Go call your husband. "I ain't got no husband."